cannibalism is Podoptera frugivora influenced by plant-induced defenses.
Hi everyone, I am Rajeev Roy. I am a student of this university and this is based off of my master's thesis research. So before we begin, let's think of the word cannibal. What comes to mind when we hear the word cannibal? For most people, the movie King Kong. But cannibalism, while we think of it more in human or primate terms, is actually a much more common phenomenon in arthropods, in particularly the Lepidoptera of them. And the insect that I am working with, this here, Podoptera frugivora, is one of the most prolific cannibals out there. Interestingly, it is also a herbivore, and a generalist herbivore at that. So think of that, a grass-eating caterpillar who loves eating each other. This is a very economically important place and found in like three continents. This picture is from India. Then you can find it in Americas, you can find it in Africa, where this caterpillar is right now responsible for like 30% of the economic slowdown that is happening in the agriculture sector. However, because this is a generalist caterpillar, it is exposed to a wide range of plant defensive compounds. Plants have defense mechanisms themselves, and this gets exposed to a wide range. So we wanted to see whether that has any link to the cannibalism behavior. But first, some background. The first instances of cannibalism that I could find in herbivore caterpillars was in 1749. From that, in 1937 to 14 period, Dr. Bethier showed that cannibalism existed even when there is ample diet. So it is not that they are feeding each other because they have nothing else to feed on. They are choosing to feed on each other. In 1999 and 2000, Dr. Chapman actually explored cannibalism in fall armyworm in particular. He wanted to see what caused this cannibalism and what were the impacts of the cannibalism. He found links with population density and a wide range of negative impacts. Some of them were like it take longer for them to pupate, there were more mortality involved, their weight gains were lower. So that raises the question, why would they do that? If it's all negative, why would they do that? Now comes the last two part. My advisor, Dr. Musser, in 2014 showed that HCA caterpillars, which are also a generalist caterpillar and prolific cannibal, choose to eat on each other, then eat diet that is less nutritious. And one of the plants that these two caterpillars feed on is probiotic, that produces nicotine in humans. In 2017, Dr. Orlov showed that congenital species of Podoptera frugivora, Podoptera exigua, turned cannibal when there was plant defenses present. In particular, he worked with methyl desmoid. My objective was to explore that idea with fall armyworm in presence of two major plant defenses. Trypsin inhibitor is found in a wide range of plants. It was first discovered in soybean, now is pretty much present in all the host plants of this particular insect. What this one does is this causes anti-nutritive defenses. The trypsin that is produced in caterpillar, which is its major protease, doesn't work as well in presence of this inhibitor. So it has to produce a lot more to get the same benefit. And when the caterpillar is producing a lot more, it's not growing. Which explains why cannibal, why they would be smaller and why the plant would want that. And nicotine is a toxin that has been used for insecticide for a long time. In fact, it's one of the most common homemade insecticides. The second part, however, the more interesting part in my opinion, is to look at whether cannibalism has some compensatory benefit. Is there there's something positive coming out of this cannibalism? So we designed the experiment with four groups. The first group had a single caterpillar with artificial diet, no toxins. So that was the optimal diet, our control group. Second group has a single caterpillar with nicotine. That we want to see what this nicotine does to the caterpillar when there is no cannibalism. Third and fourth group, the cannibalism group, three caterpillars, all of similar size, with just diet or diet laced with toxin. Each of the groups have data replicates. We gave them 48-hour observation period and repeated that exact same thing with trypsin inhibitor, only with a higher observation period. So let's look at some. I might have finished. So this is a video of the cannibalism happening in action. If you look at this, the caterpillar is actually feeding on it while that is still alive. You can still sort of see the movement from that side. Not really a pleasant watch, pretty gruesome, goes on for hours. On the other side, this is the diet consumption with the toxin and without the toxin. This is just the artificial diet we're talking about. The control group has almost four times diet consumption than of nicotine. So when they are eating each other, they are not eating the diet. On the other hand, the trypsin inhibitor is double that of nicotine but half that of control. So this can actually give us some idea of what cannibalism we are going to expect. That it should be highest in nicotine, lowest here, medium here. Let's see if that matches up. So these are the bioassay results. Each of these were counted as one replicate. So one paper is if there is an instance of cannibalism, that is one. And by looking 12 hours, we start seeing cannibalism taking place. By 36 hours, all three replicates are showing cannibalism when there is nicotine present. In comparison, control, just one. And this is the caterpillar that does cannibalism anyways. At the end of our observation, it's a 5-time scan. So the nicotine is definitely causing something to take place that is driving the cannibalism. Let's look at it if it matches with the trypsin inhibitor. And as you can see, due to the increased observation period, you have another bar here. And as we saw with control, nicotine one, this is also showing an increased cannibalism. Two times, not as much as nicotine. Now, if you see here, what did we say? Diet consumption, least at nicotine. Cannibalism, most at nicotine. Diet consumption, medium at trypsin inhibitor. Cannibalism, medium at trypsin inhibitor. Diet consumption, maximum at control. Cannibalism, minimum at control. However, we still wanted to see at a gene expression level, at a transcriptome level, if we can find some benefits. So this was the method that I used to do my gene expression assay. We extracted focal RNA from caterpillars that were less frozen using Prysol. Then the RNA samples were converted to cDNA. cDNA concentrations were normalized to 300 nanogram per microliter. And those cDNA were then utilized in qPCR to actually look at the gene expression at a quantitative level. So here we have the digestive genes from the nicotine step. If you look at this, trypsin gets downregulated when there is only nicotine. But, see something? Control and cannibalism are going both doing the exact same thing. So cannibalism is causing it to revert back. Then you have CLCP. This is another protease enzyme. And while we see a much upregulation in case of cannibalism, nicotine still calls it down-regulated. One inch is a carbohydrate enzyme and shows similar trends with that of insulin, but a little bit of regulation. This one is also very interesting. This is pyrimidine. Pyrimidine is another one of the major enzymes that are protease degrading. And as you can see here, it is massively upregulated in presence of nicotine. But the expression profile is basically similar when there is control on cannabis. We also looked at some defensive genes to see whether it provided something more than just depression. Carboxylesterase, GHP, BLL2, and propanol oxidase. Carboxylesterase and GHP are both detoxification genes. So the more toxin there is, you want it to be expressed more. And what do we see? It is expressed more when there is cannibalism. Then there is BLL2. This is a viral gene that has become embedded in the caterpillar genome and gives resistance to bacterial infection. See something here? This is down regulated. Caterpillars are getting more susceptible to bacterial infection. It's not opposite. Propanol oxidase is both the immune linked gene, also leads to melanization. This one I need to look more into, but it can be both positive or negative. With trypsin inhibitor, we have this digestive genes first, and as you can see, because it's a trypsin inhibitor, the gene expression of trypsin is massively upregulated. This is the fold reference, this is 1566. Control and cannibalism, both down to 1. Chymotrypsin, same trend we saw with nicotine. CLCP, again upregulated in presence of protease inhibitor. 1 inch, same trend. So the trend change, if we ignore the middle, is same with nicotine or trypsin inhibitor. So this result is influenced more by cannibalism than by the toxin. The defensive gene expression, carboxylesterase, GHP, propo, exactly same as we saw with nicotine. Once again, we are focusing just on the red part, the cannibalism part. This part is independently monitored. Because it is same with nicotine and trypsin inhibitor. The toxin check is not influencing. That leads to my conclusions that there is evidence to the hypothesis that plant secondary metabolites will induce cannibalism in fall animal. Also, there is some benefit. It provides nutritional source of diet. We saw the gene expression changes. Also, there is expression change of defensive genes, which can have far wide-ranging conclusions that we can think of. It may lead to higher tolerance of insecticide. It may actually shorten their living span. We don't know. Now, I would like to give thanks to my advisor, Dr. Masur, for bringing me into this project, Dr. Hamasur for helping me with the qPCR, Dr. Pat Dow of USDA for supplying the caterpillars, Department of Biological Science in Western Illinois University, the RISE program for helping me fund this, and the Plant Animal Interaction Class. These are the students there who helped me with the setting up of the bioassays. Any questions?